This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today, we're talking to Dr. Megan Rose, I hope. We've been at this for a while. There have been a lot of glitches, but we're now using Megan's Zoom, and hopefully it will work. As my listeners know, Megan, this is a haunted show. Not the only one. Other podcasters, when they talk about the world of the dead, have similar problems. Okay, where I would like to begin, folks, with this show is in a funny kind of a place. I'm going to read from something called the Florida of Apuleius of Madaurura. The Florida means the flowers, and he was a Roman author. And this is going to give you an idea of something that we have lost in our world. This was written when the world was still enchanted. And it's a description of what it would have been like if you'd been walking down a road between cities in ancient times. "I cannot conceive," he writes, "anything that could give a traveler just a cause to halt in sign of reverence. No altar crowned with flowers, no grotto shadowed with foliage, no oak bedecked with thorns, no beech garlanded with the skins of beasts, no mound whose engirdling hedge proclaims its sanctity, no tree trunk hewn into the semblance of a god, no turf still wet with libations, no stone astream with precious unguents, for these are but small things." And they were small in those days. They were everywhere because we considered the world around us to be sacred. You will never find anything like that anywhere anymore. It's gone. But the world is still here, and the world is still sacred. We're going to be talking to Megan today about her book, Spirit Marriage, Intimate Relationships with Otherworldly Beings, because we can reconnect with the world in a deep, profound way, not just by thinking about it, but by marrying the conscious entities that are in other levels of reality, like the one right back there, to whom I am, as you know, actively married right now. Megan has a doctorate in East-West psychology from the California Institute of Integral Studies, a master's in religion and society from the Graduate Theological Union. And beyond that, she's an initiated ceremonial magician, a Shakta tantric practitioner, a senior seer in the House of Bright Fairy Seership. She serves as an ordained interfaith minister and psychospiritual counselor, and is the executive director of the Entheosis Institute. So this is a, in some respects, a conventional resume of a theologian, but it departs from that. What is the House of Bright Fairy Seership, for example, Megan?
House of Bright Fairy Seership is the institute founded by Orion Foxwood, who I know has been on your show before. And it is really the flowering, the gifting, the outcome of his marriage to his spirit wife, who is the fairy queen, Bree. And so, in my book, I talk about Orion and his union with Bree. I interview Orion. He writes the foreword for my book. and I interview Orion amongst a variety of other people. But Bree is this powerful fairy or primordial presence that came to him and was a guiding tutelary spirit for a while. And then they were married in the folkloric fairy rite, and a whole lineage of teaching flowed out of that union. And that is really indicative of the type of things that can arise from these deep bonded relationships and marriages with otherworldly beings.
Now, in my case, my marriage, I think, is with my wife, who became an otherworldly being after she passed away physically. It's possible that this is not the case. She said a fascinating thing, though, after she died. She said, "I'm not Anne anymore, but I will always be Anne for you." And I think I would like to describe exactly what happened. And you can tell me what you think this is. I was at a conference in 2016 and in a hotel room, and I was doing my evening meditation. It was about 11 o'clock at night. And I saw suddenly the interior of a vesica Pisces like this hanging in the air in front of me. It was totally black. And at first I thought, is it that a shadow? But then no, it was clearly not. And when I realized this is not a shadow, it moved very slowly and carefully toward me and then turned and lay down across my feet. And I began to feel this most exquisite energy coming into my body through my feet. And since then, I have felt it 1,000,000 times. It happens every day at least once or twice, and usually, and all kinds of funny things happen. Like, for example, if I should fall asleep in a meeting, it'll be there immediately and it'll be real powerful. It'll wake me right up. And that's why I think it's my wife, because when I fell asleep in movies or meetings or plays in the past, she would always jerk me and say, "Wake up." Mm-hmm. It also comes down onto my midriff at night, and it's has weight. It can, and it's very subtle and careful. It doesn't drop down. It comes and rests, comes to rest slowly. And then this energy goes through my body that is absolutely extraordinary. So it's a mixture of the erotic and the sensual and the spiritual all in one. Is this my wife? It seems like it to me. I wear both rings still because of this.
You know, I think that, you know, you're the expert on diagnosing what that is. And if it has the flavor and the sense and the sort of resonance of your wife, then I would work with it in that framework. These otherworldly beings, you know, I use the term otherworldly or spirit, because it's sort of the broadest sense of what, you know, we understand to be not physically in a human body in this moment, but it really runs the gamut of deities and angels and beloved dead, ancestors, fairies, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the discernment process of, you know, I'm having this encounter, and what is, you know, what is this? Is this an angel? Is this a deity? Is this, you know, that discernment process is one of the skills that, you know, the practitioner has to really, you know, it's like building the muscle of discernment to, you know, really determine who am I being contacted by and why. But it feels like there is also a certain amount of volition that we have as a practitioner to request or to even shape the experience. Meaning, in my own case with my spirit contact, the being that was contacting me was this deep sort of primordial, vegetative, horned god type deity, but vast and not really fixed to one identity. And over the years, as I was developing the contact, we sort of agreed on a deity form Gwynep Neith, who is a Welsh lord of the dead and lord of the fairy people, as sort of the best, closest approximation of how I would work with my contact. But he's very clear in saying that he's not limited to that. And I think that's really important, like limited to that one fixed ideation or entity. And so I think that that's a really wonderful example of when we're not talking about something that is bound by time and space and physicality, there is so much more flexibility for these beings to dance with a variety of different flavors and embodiments. And for many, many years when I was working on developing the contact, Gwen, which is sort of what I call him now, because that's the name we settled on, would shapeshift and show up like a lot of different things. And the only thing that I could really count on was that it felt the same. The somatic feeling presence of it had a very unique response that it elicited in my body, similar to what you're describing with your wife. And so what I love about this is that, you know, psychologist Stan Grof talks about contact with, you know, non-ordinary beings. And he said that, you know, the visual, how they show up is less important than the somatic. The somatic is sort of because, you know, we can, they can put on all kinds of different costumes. Orion Foxwood likes to say that Bree reaches into the drag closet of his mind and pulls out a different costume to convey different things that she's trying to express to him. So I think of like gender and vision, like visionary, what they show up visually like as a language. And the somatic is more like how it feels to us is more of an indication of the rightness, the trueness, the authenticity of the contact.
Well, that interesting is this question of authenticity, because it's easy to invent this. And yet when it's not invented, it's very clearly not invented. In my case, I've only seen the one thing, the vesica Pisces. Mm-hmm. and that's all. I haven't ever seen anything else. I did hear Anne trying to talk in a seance that I reported on Dreamland a few weeks ago, which I'm sure my listeners remember. But these entities, there are many of them out there. And I want to move now to just, you know, of course, you know very well that the Christian community, the Christian right, hates all of this and considers it all demonic and is very paternalistic and very much part of the past. Doesn't know it yet, but it will. And what is the difference between demon and daemon? And why is this not what they say it is?
Yeah, so the daemon, right, is a term that is used, I believe it was Socrates that coined the term. It is spelled D-A-E-M-O-N or D-A-I-M-O-N. And it's the word demon is kind of a misinterpretation or a bastardization of the word daemon. In Socrates and Plato's time, the daemon was a guiding tutelary or teaching spirit that each of us were born with, and that we kind of think of it in more common terms as like the angel or the demon on the two shoulders. That's kind of what it became degraded into. But originally those were one being, and it was a guiding intelligence that was most often benevolent. And I say most often because that sometimes we think that these beings should solve all of our problems and answer all of our questions, and everything should work out the way that we think that they should work out. And sometimes, and often the tutelary spirit is trying to guide us in onto our truest and highest path. And sometimes that's a little painful. So these tutelary spirits were otherworldly beings that humans had the potential to have a deep bonded relationship with that guided them. And Socrates was very well known for having this tutelary spirit that he referred to for much of his teachings and work. And it's really only been, you know, the past couple thousand years with the rise of the church and the sort of the agenda of some of the you know, Christian authorities to take away the rights and the power of the individual to reach through to the other world and place in place of that their gods, their spirits, their clergy, right? That was mediating.
To disempower the relationship between the individual and the spirit world.
Exactly.
This is very much what it's about.
Yeah.
What has been put in between them, though, is something that actually doesn't necessarily have such a relationship. I may or may not. I mean, some priests and preachers, I'm sure, do, but not all. But it's not right, I don't think. We have all God.
Right.
This right. power. To do this if we wish to. I would like to talk now a little bit to move on into this, to talking about a little bit about some of the early, the people who began to bring this into the world, in the modern world, as it were. I'm particularly thinking of your discussion of Carl Jung and his Red Book. And the reason I bring it up in particular is I read the Red Book with my reading group I've been in for many years, over a two-year period. We read and discussed the Red Book. And I'd like you to talk a little bit about what Jung discovered. And folks, some of you already know the difficulties that are there with Jung, and I'll just refer to them, that he was briefly deluded into believing the Nazis, and he after the war said, I made a mistake. And during the war, he was briefly taken to Germany. They tried to make him into a spokesman for Nazism, and he realized this was completely insane at the time. So I just refer to that because I know that'll be in some minds. I don't think it's a very important part of his legacy. But an important, very important part of his legacy is the Red Book. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the spirit entities and how he regarded them, which is different from the way, say, I regard Anne as a real being, a semi-physical presence in my life. Mm-hmm. And that's, in fact, what she is. Mm-hmm. So, but go ahead and talk a little bit for us about Jung.
Yeah. So Jung, and we cite Jung because that Jung's influence on contemporary psychology can't be, it can't be diminished. It's so much of our contemporary psychological theory is rooted in Jung, even though, you know, there were times where he was a problematic figure. But one of the things that is remarkable about Jung and that really only has come to light in the last 10 years is this Red Book encounters that he was having. It was at a time in his life where he had studied with Freud was already a fairly well established psychologist. And he started having kind of these experiences with what he referred to as inner figures, but that what really clearly to him over his years of exploring these relationships, became obvious that they were beings, that they were kind of entities that he was having these conversations with. And, you know, during the initial encounters, he thought, well, I could be going mad, and I could try and suppress this, or I could just lean in. And if I lean in, I need to just allow myself to go fully into these conversations. And so that's what he did. He leaned in, he documented the experiences that he was having in this gorgeous illuminated manuscript, The Red Book, which is, he's got paintings and drawings and all of his writing of these encounters that he was having. And one of the figures that was very prominent during this time was a figure called Philemon, which was this sort of tutelary spirit, inner aspect, but also this, it became really clear that this was an intelligence that was beyond just Jung's core self or core personality. And Philemon would reveal to him some of Jung's most major psychological theories. And later on in life, he would attribute these psychological theories, things like the collective unconscious and the anima and the animus and archetypes, he would attribute it to Philemon's teaching. So here we have a otherworldly or an extraordinary intelligence that is giving, you know, information to a scholar and is taking this information and integrating it and developing teaching systems around that. And he's not the only person that did this. Rudolf Steiner attributes most of his anthroposophical teaching to a group he calls the Masters that were otherworldly beings that he was working with as well. But in both cases of both scholars, the families repressed this information for a number of years, although neither scholar ever retracted that their theories had come from otherworldly beings, the families, because they were afraid that they were going to be, you know, discredited by this sort of out there otherworldly contact, suppressed this information until fairly recently. So,
yes. Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say, so here we have two really great examples, and they're not the only ones people who created foundational systems of psychology, philosophy, et cetera, who are attributing their knowledge to these guiding spirits.
We're going to take our first break now, folks. We'll be right back. Free Dreamlanders subscribers will keep right on keeping on. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us? In you, unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. And subscribers, please do take a look at the new edition of Communion, and especially the audiobook. We're talking to Megan Rose. Her website is drmeganrose.com. Her new book, and it's a powerful, important book, is Spirit Marriage, Intimate Relationships with Otherworldly Beings. Before we go on, Megan, I think it is important to ask this question. There will be people here listening who want to get into a spirit marriage. What route should they take? Mine came to me. I mean, I wasn't expecting it, but it did. And of course, Anne was always a very unexpected human being. You never could be sure what would happen next in that wonderful life I had with her in the physical. So, but how would they do it? What do they do?
Yeah. So, you know, in the spirit marriage relationship, there's a proposal. And if we're looking at the traditional sort of folkloric accounts of this, the spirit is, or the deity. So I use the term spirit, but that's just sort of my catch-all for any sort of otherworldly being that isn't currently in a human physical body at this time. So we could be talking about deities or angels or fairies or any number of these otherworldly beings. It's typically in the very traditional practice proposed by the spirit to the individual. It also happens where the spirit or the deity will go to like an elder or a mentor and say to the elder or mentor, I want to marry so-and-so. And then the invitation will be precipitated that way. However, you know, we know that we can have deeply devoted, loving, bonded relationships with otherworldly beings. And right now I'm thinking of like the practice in the tantric traditions of the Ishta Devi or Ishta Devata, the one's chosen deity. And so much of those practices are around seeking and finding one's deity, one's divine self, and then stepping into deep devotional relationship that can lead into a kind of bonded marriage. And so when people come to me and say, I'm really interested in this, what do I, you know, how do I go about it? I if you don't already have a spirit that is sort of ringing your doorbell saying, I'd like to marry you, then I encourage folks to find a devotional deity, a devotional spirit that they know, like, and trust. And again, begin the wooing process, begin the process of getting to know them. It's not all that different from human relationship in that there is a process of needing to really discern who is the entity that I'm working with? What are they about? What would be the purpose of this union? Do I want to deepen this commitment and deepen this relationship? And so you spend time getting to know them. You spend time with them, just like you would a human person. And from that, you may arise the desire to step into this deeper marriage. And the marriage, and again, I use the term marriage because that's the most common term that we understand for a deeply committed, bonded relationship with someone. But marriage historically has been entered into for a variety of different reasons. Sometimes it's love and romance. Sometimes it's to have a country, or, you know, rule, like we think of the marriages between kings and queens of countries. Sometimes it's to do some sort of a project or have a family. So we spend time getting to know the spirits that we might be interested in deepening with. And then the marriage happens because that there is a very clear union that that needs to take place for that co-creative project to come out into the world. And again, marriage isn't the only term that's used for this. Sometimes it's called a merge or a symbiosis or an indwelling, but it's the idea that the human consciousness and the otherworldly consciousness have come together in such an integrated way that the two beings share a co-creative or a co-creative consciousness, a sort of symbiote kind of relationship. The way Orion Foxwood describes it is, he says he closes his eyes and he sees into his fairy wife Bree's world. He opens his eyes and she sees into his world. But it's also not necessarily like this impinging consciousness that is there 24/7. There can be times where the spirit recedes more into their world, or the human is more in doing their daily mundane things, but the reach or the contact is much more immediate and the presence can often be persistent.
You know, you say a very interesting thing here when you describe Orion's, and I do remember him mentioning this in his interview on Dreamland in 2017. When you close your eyes, you see into their world, and when you open them, they see into yours. I'd never thought of this before, but a couple of summers ago, I found that when I closed my eyes, I was seeing a vividly complex, rich other world, which my listeners know all about this because I've even written about it in my book, A New World. And I actually physically entered it a couple of times. I'm in the physical. But then they got all outraged at me. It hadn't occurred to me until this moment that is the world, that is their world. And, you know, we have increasing proof in physics that there is a mirror universe. In other words, that we are literally a mirror image. There's another universe. And I'm wondering if all of the stories of going through the looking glass and so forth and so on don't have a ring of an element of truth in them. Have you ever had a direct contact with this other world? I know Orion has.
Yeah, I think it's more accurate to say other worlds. If you look at the folkloric texts that come out of Wales, like the Mabinogion and other texts, we're not just talking about one other monolithic other world. We're talking about other worlds nested within other worlds, nested within other worlds. So, you know, kind of more like this multiverse, perhaps, that's been postulated with, you know, some quantum physics. But a version of that where the other world, like there's the other world of the dead and the ancestors, there's another world of the fae, there's other worlds where other kinds of beings are there. And sometimes you can transmigrate between the, you know, and go back and forth. And in some of the folkloric accounts, humans can go into one other world or another or between them. So I think, and then, you know, we're just talking about terrestrial, there's cosmically, you know, a sort of an infinite number of worlds we could be connecting to. And so, you know, remember when we are in our physical form, right, we're bound by time and space and physicality, but in these otherworldly spaces, it is much more fluid. And so the ability to move and drop into these different frames, I think, becomes a part of the work of the otherworldly adept. And certainly we see this in some of the traditions like in the Egyptian Book of the Dead or the Tibetan Book of the Dead, where they're really training the human, training the consciousness of the human, that part of us which persists with beyond death, to learn how to navigate. You know, in the Tibetan tradition, they call it the bardos, but to learn how to navigate between these different otherworldly places that we could potentially travel to, avoid the ones that are more problematic, or where we may get kind of stuck, and move into the worlds where we can continue to do work in the afterlife or perhaps reincarnate. So I think that, part of what spirit marriage, part of the gift is that we are then constantly or persistently connected to an otherworldly being that that gives us access, that can potentially open the doors to those other worlds for various purposes.
I always get into scrapes trying to go into other worlds and annoy, but I've always, Annie used to say, you really are the most annoying human being I've ever known. And I think that may still be true. In any case, true or not, we're going to take a little break and we're going to go in a different direction. It's not a different direction exactly, but we're going to go into some of the practical levels of this after we come back. And we're going to be talking about something called the Abramelin operation. And it should be very interesting. Free Dreamlanders will be right back. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. The UNX Network delivers quality paranormal programming, video and audio streams, all kinds of shows. Jimmy Church is there, Dreamland is there in the free version. So go to unxnetwork.com and you'll receive your monthly newsletter, blog access, event notices, and a free digital copy of their quarterly magazine. How can you go wrong? Check it out, unxnetwork.com. We're talking to Dr. Megan Rose, her new book, and it is something else, Spirit Marriage, Intimate Relationships with Other Worldly Beings. As you have heard, you can do this. This is a very disruptive show. It's intended to enable you to actually do these things. And you're told not to on many different levels and warned about it. And people love to experience fear as a form of entertainment and to spread it. I know that very well because I was once a horror novelist and I'm good at doing that. But people love it, but it's not right, especially not when we're trying to enter a world of people like that, like Annie back there, who is hardly something out of a horror novel. And now, this question of the Abramelin operation, Melin operation, is fascinating to me for two reasons. First, Megan will explain this in a moment, but I'm going to tell you why it's fascinating. First, because it's had such a powerful effect on human life. And second, I have a huge question. Could it be used now? Could people who or in contact in this way somehow help the planet? Because right now, it seems that everybody who gets into a place of power in this world is either ineffective or horrible. I don't see there's anyone else. So we need help. Tell us what it is first, and tell us a little bit about its history. And then I'll ask you whether or not we could use it as a force for good.
Well, the Abramelin operation is typically used by ceremonial magicians to step into what is called the knowledge and conversation with the Holy Guardian Angel. And the Holy Guardian Angel is an aspect of the human that is, I think it's more accurate to say actually that the human is an aspect of the Holy Guardian Angel. So we talk about, and your listeners may have encountered terms of like the higher self, right, or the divine self. And the Holy Guardian Angel, when you look at it in the ceremonial order texts that describe it, is something beyond the higher self. It is what I like to refer to as the divine self. It is the wise intelligence that is that gives life and form and shape to the manifest universe. And I won't go too into the Kabbalistic teachings on this, but there is this understanding that, you know, from the zero point, from the void, things began to manifest, and they manifest into the 10,000 things. And so the way I like to think of it is, you know, you are the fingertip, right, of the divine pushing its way into the human world, making an impact. You're able to pick up things and create things and have a very physicalized impact on incarnation. The divine, or the divine self, is upstream from that. Maybe it's the body or the cosmic intelligence that is then pushing your expression out into the world. And there may be other people who are incarnated, like the fingertips of the God, that are downstream from this divine intelligence. So In the ceremonial tradition, finding the name, right, or the identity of your divine self, of this Holy Guardian Angel, is one of the greatest undertakings that a magician can take on. And the Abramelin operation is simply one set of rituals, it's not even a set of rituals. It's a sort of protocol that one can undertake to quest for the knowledge and conversation with this Holy Guardian Angel. So the idea is to establish a contact so that you can then reach back and even sort of lean back into that divine intelligence, and it becomes kind of the guiding principle. So in my research, I interviewed a ceremonial magician, a very high level adept, who had successfully completed this operation. And he shared with me how the operation took place over 3 days, but the actual operation or the ritual itself took place over 3 days, but he had spent 3 years preparing himself for this 3-day ritual. And in the ritual, one is sort of hermetically sealed into a temple chamber that one has to construct for themselves. And it requires support from the community, because that, you know, you need people making sure that, you know, you have food and that you're protected and that, you know, the temple is sealed and upheld. And so what he described when he did the operation was that a lot of the rituals that he did to prepare for it were things that he then took into the functioning of the ritual itself, but they weren't necessarily prescribed. They were things that he had to divine and discern with the knowledge that he had built up as a ceremonial magician, as well as his various contacts. And the goal then is that at some point in that 3-day journey where you're, you know, in constant ritual, he said he would set a alarm clock and he would do ritual, and then he would set his alarm clock and he would sleep for a little while, and the alarm clock would wake him up and he would do some more ritual. And he just did that constantly for 3 days. And by the end of that process, he said he had this powerful experience. And he said it was kind of like a reverse Kundalini awakening, where this lightning bolt kind of came from the top of his head and ricocheted down through his body. And he said he was taken to his knees, flat on his back, prostrate from this this energy. Well, what he said was interesting about, or you know, the manifestation of that contact was that it wasn't like that. He says, you know, in his story, it wasn't like he had Harvey sitting next to him, riding shotgun with him, you know, constantly, you know, telling him what to do. He said that, you know, after that, he couldn't really do ritual for a few years. He said he was really back to the very basics, chop wood, carry water. But when he would ask, what do I need to do? Like, what is the outcome of this? How do I serve my community? Because he led a temple at that time, ceremonial magic temple. He said that he got just this download, just like a ticker tape of not one thing that he could teach, but like a whole teaching system. And that's really consistent with what Orion described about his union with Bree. This whole teaching system came through these unions. And so, you know, the Abra Melon operation is one kind of ritual that you can look up and sort of shape your quest around, but you know, it's not something that is rushed into. It takes months, if not years, to build up the practices, the things that you'll do, the contact, so that when you go into the ritual and you create that space for yourself, you have success. Because doing that work and not having success can be a really shattering experience, and then you know, there's to the psyche. So I think that what I really loved about Frater Lux's story is when, you know, we were sort of sharing, and I was sharing experiences that I'd had with my divine self. It wasn't the Abra Melon operation that precipitated that. It was something else. But yet we knew that the contact was genuine because of, you know, it's this experience that you almost can't put into words. Like, how do you know the sound of your own soul? How do you know the sound of the divine? You know it. It's something that is almost irrefutable from a individual personal gnosis place.
Yeah, I love the way that you blur the line between your presence in this and the presence of an external spirit. The higher guardian angel is at once part of you and above you. Would that be an accurate way of?
I think so too. And I think that, you know, I think we humans in human bodies right now are really into this and that and discerning, right? We like, well, I'm me and you're you. And there's this clear separation, right? We have all these binary separating kinds of ways that we orient ourselves. But I think when we move out of the time, space, physicality that we are embedded within, things just become much more fluid and up and down and in and out and me and you. It's not the same rules. And so, you know, we can be both in a marriage and in a conversation with a spirit beloved, as well as our divine self. I didn't necessarily think that when I first started my research. I was like, spirit marriage is this thing where a human marries this other thing and they form a new thing. And then the divine self is me, but more than me. And then I met the Shakta Tantric, who is both married to the goddess Kali, but Kali is also her divine self, her Ishtadevi. And that just opened up a whole new avenue of inquiry because, you know, depending on who you talk to, the ceremonial magicians will say, no, you can't marry your divine self. That's not how we work with it. But when I poked Frater Lex a little more on the subject, he's like, well, marriage actually isn't an incorrect term. We just shy away from it because of all the connotations that we have with marriage. And it, you know, what it comes down to is that in some of the ceremonial traditions, and I won't say all of them, the erotic relationship with the divine self isn't something that's focused on or even encouraged. But you know, if we trot over to the Indic and the Tantric practices, there are that the erotic practices that uses the vitalism of the body, that uses the awakening, quickening energy of the body to connect to the divine and to connect to the divine self. And that is a part of their practice. So, you know, part of it is which practice are you working with? We don't necessarily want to muddy all the practices, but we also want to understand that these hard and fast rules that the traditions have created may be more for the preservation of the tradition, as well as what their sort of intended outcome is. And they're not necessarily a monolithic, this is true for everybody, or this is true for all psycho-spiritual encounters.
That makes a lot of sense. You know, we've got the last break coming up in a couple of minutes. So instead of waiting a couple of minutes, this is an ideal time to take it now. We will take our last break for Free Dreamlanders. We're talking to Dr. Megan Rose. Her book is Spirit Marriage. Her website is drmeganrose.com. And Megan, what can listeners and viewers do when they get on your website? Can they contact you? And what do you have?
Absolutely. I have a variety of different things on my website. I have a course that people can take, a self-study course on spirit marriage, which really takes people into the nuts and bolts of how to develop one of these types of relationships for yourselves. It's got psycho-spiritual practices, as well as the sort of historical roots of this. I have sessions. I work individually with people who are interested in either spirit marriage or a sort of psycho-spiritual development. So you can go onto my website and poke around, and as well as a whole bunch of different interviews. I have a series that I call Sit and Sip with Dr. Megan Rose, and I've interviewed a variety of different spirit marriage practitioners, as well as given different talks on everything from re-enchantment to animism to sacred sexuality.
All right. On that note, we'll be right back. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010 talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one. This show with Alan Lammers, you will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. The UNX Network delivers quality paranormal programming, video and audio streams, all kinds of shows. Jimmy Church is there. Dreamland is there in the free version. So go to unxnetwork.com and you'll receive your monthly newsletter, blog access, event notices, and a free digital copy of their quarterly magazine. How can you go wrong? Check it out, unxnetwork.com. We're talking to Dr. Megan Rose about spirit marriage, and it is something that I think that we live in a world that has gone soul blind, and you have to open your eyes. You have to have your vision cleared in order to see what's real. And I've been fortunate in that I had that done by the visitors who started to try to wake me up in, actually it was the summer of 1985, and they couldn't succeed and came back and forth trying to fulfill what was an obligation to them that had been incurred by a pact that I had made in my between lives that I have now remembered but didn't know at the time. Finally, they just got sick of it and beat me up in December of 1985, which became what's known as the communion experience. Mm-hmm. Over the years, the years after that, the next few years, I had both a physical and a spiritual marriage with one of these entities who came to me a number of times in the physical and had physical sex with me. And it was very disturbing to me because I was so embarrassed because I couldn't stop it. And I was physically helpless. I was not able to move when it happened. And it was so intense, I didn't want to move anyway, to be honest with you. So, and I felt like I was being disloyal to my wife. And I told her about it, and she was completely unbothered by it. To the extent that my friend Jeffrey Kripal, the professor Jeffrey Kripal, with whom I wrote the book Supernatural, evolved the theory that maybe this was Anne. This entity was also Anne. And what is that about? Do you have any thoughts about the reason I brought it up, of course, is we've just been talking about this blurred line between the self and the spirit world externally. And it might not be so blurred because, I mean, I had physical sex with this being. And I even know one of the people who was there to witness it. So it happened. What happened, do you think? Do you think it was, in some sense, it was Anne?
And Anne was incarnate at the time, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, you know, like I said, I really think of humans as constellate beings, like a constellation of beings and intelligences. I mean, even if we look at it from like an Asagioli psychosynthesis perspective, we have all these lovely inner aspects of ourself that is our sort of local self. And then we have other aspects of our extraordinary self that are nested within, as we were just discussing, deity, but other perhaps strains or manifestations of beings. So, you know, you look at like the folkloric fairy accounts of humans mating with the fairies and then giving birth to offspring that are then hybrid fairy and human offspring, that even as recent as, you know, Dion Fortune's writings in the 1940s was talking about these kinds of hybrid beings. And so that means that our human DNA may not be as human as we think it is, right? And so that then gives us, if we sort of open ourselves to that line of inquiry, that means that we are composite or nested beings within a lot of different otherworldly groups. And so, you know, was it Anne's fairy self that was encountering? Was it an aspect of her divine self? Was it her, you know, in the witchcraft traditions, we talk about the fetch. There are, you know, the human consciousness and even the human body has many different layers and many different manifestations of consciousness. And, you know, we can't go too far down the rabbit hole of esoteric body theory, but suffice it to say that there are layers of the human body that is the physical, the subtle, the morphic, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that, you know, what is paramount in these types of discussions is that we cultivate what I call the 3 Ds of spirit marriage, or really of any kind of extraordinary contact. And that is devotion, first and foremost. What are we devoted to? And that is really establishing the know, like, and trust factor with the beings that we're working with. So we want, and my research really has focused primarily on beneficent beings that we know, we like, we trust them, we even fall in love with them. And so we want that type of devotional relationship with them. And then the second practice is discernment, really being able to discern what is the spirit, what does it want, what is the agenda, is it this, is it that? And that is a whole art of discernment, right? That uses divination you know, in my own discernment process, it was like divination, mentorship from people that were my elders that could help me discern, tools, teachings, spiritual technologies, rituals that helped constellate my magical body so that I could discern what was coming as like an inner aspect of me versus something that was more external to me. And then discipline is the 3rd D, and that is doing the practices, doing the work, showing up every day and building, right? These aren't things that just happen overnight. We build them, we cultivate, we develop the practices in the magical body and the discipline practice of getting to know the otherworldly beings. You know, if you had a person that you were wanting to get to know, you wouldn't expect to know them if you didn't spend time with them. And so we have to spend time with these beings. And sometimes we don't know. I will tell you, Whitley, that at the beginning of this whole research inquiry, it was precipitated because this being came to me and said, I want to marry you. And I didn't know who the heck it was or what it wanted. And so I spent, so the marriage proposal happened like in 2002, and we didn't actually get married till 2018. I spent years trying to discern and really understand. And it really was the seed of inquiry that gave rise to what became my PhD dissertation and now this book, was trying to discern. And I decided that discerning wasn't just about reading all the historical accounts, but talking to people living in this day and age that practice this and understanding how they did it so that I could better discern who this contact was. And, you know, like I said earlier, what became clear was that there was some negotiation as to who the contact was going to constellate as for me, because that because that there's some fluidity there. So, you know, it doesn't exactly answer your question, but I think that it, you know, it gives this sense of like, we have to show up and do the work on our side to cultivate the relationship.
Well, that is so important. If you don't show up, nothing happens. And that's why I do my work, which is known as the sensing exercise that my listeners all know about. And the subscribers can find examples of on the website every day, 3 times a day, every day, 7 days a week, unless I'm physically unable to do so. Very interesting to me is this, how these relationships work. Like I know how my relationship with my wife works. It can be very sensual, never sexual, not anymore, but very sensual. And I want to ask you about the relationship you have and who you are, who it is with. How well do you know them at this point?
Yeah. So, like I said, and I can't remember, I apologize, Whitley, because that since we've had like 3 different stops and starts, I can't remember what I've said in this, this take.
Okay. Well, you were talking about the request for marriage that mm-hmm. happened in 2004, I believe. And then all the years later, mm-hmm. you finally sort of said yes and mm-hmm. opened yourself to this. Mm-hmm. And what was it like after, what is it like? I guess you're still married. And what is it like, this marriage like for you? What's mm-hmm. your experience of it?
It's interesting. Originally, the relationship was very much the being. Gwen would come to me when I was dreaming, and it was very erotic in the beginning. And that was actually the somatic cue that I would know that it was Gwen. I would have this very strong arousal, but not in a purely sexual way. It was like I would be lit up like a Christmas tree, like everything would go into exaltation. And that was very connected to my Kundalini Shakti. So this innate vitality in my body would sort of shoot up my spine, and I would go into this exalted state, most often in dreams when I was encountering this being. And he would show up in a whole host of different visuals, right? For anything from like deities and angels and plants and animals. I mean, it was the gamut. But what I would know, and the reason I would know it is him, is because I would have the same somatic response, which is what, you know, we talked about, Stan Groff said is sort of the telltale sign of the encounter. Over the years, the erotic aspect of it lessened. And at first I was like, well, you know, why? And then as I began my research, one of the things that I realized is that what we think of as, you know, sex here in the West, or sexuality here in the West, we kind of have 2 categories for it. We have sex for pleasure and sex for procreation. And that's sort of our very limited understanding of sexual energy. But if you step into, say, the tantric worldview, sexual energy or eroticism is the vitalizing of the body. It is the awakening of the divine within us, and precipitates our extrasensory capacities. So the idea of a Kundalini rising or Kundalini awakening often hastens the development of paranormal gifts and abilities in the individual. And so often these kinds of erotic encounters with a being is for that purpose. And I won't say that's true for every single spirit marriage practitioner, but for the ones that I interviewed and the research that I did, this was true for many, many, many of them. But not everybody has erotic encounters with their spirit contacts. Sometimes, like we talked about, the tutelary beings, but even in the spirit marriage, eroticism, as you shared in your case, isn't necessarily like de rigueur. It doesn't have to be there as part of the relationship. It really just depends on the nature of what you're doing and the outcome of the marriage. But as I said, those encounters began to lessen, and then the encounters in my dreams began to lessen entirely. And I thought, oh no, what's happening? Am I losing the contact? And what I realized at that point, this was about 7 or 8 years in, was that I had been expecting the contact to always reach me. I'd been expecting Gwen. It was kind of like when you're in a relationship with someone and you always expect them to be the one to invite or to call or to reach out, and you're never reciprocating that back. I hadn't been developing the rituals, the tools, the practices that I reached through to him. And so that sort of hastened a period of me really developing daily rituals, daily practices to reach through. And again, you know, during this whole period, I was interviewing people and researching what others were doing and how they were doing it, and using some of that to shape my own practices. And then when the marriage happened, you know, I had thought, after interviewing all these people and the nature of their marriages and how the marriages happened, I had thought that it was going to be some big fete, you know, some marriage ceremony ritual that I had with my community there. And it didn't happen like that. I was in a ritual. It was a Samhain or a Halloween ritual that was part of the reclaiming community here in the San Francisco Bay Area. And I was actually priestessing an altar for the beloved dead. But it was in that ritual that the marriage happened spontaneously. So nobody else in the ritual knew that my marriage was going to happen that night. But there is a visionary practice that we do every year as part of this Samhain ritual called the ritual is called the spiral dance. And within it, there's a guided visualization where everybody, like 300-400 people, lay down on the floor and we travel to the other world. We travel to the Isle of Apples, to the farther shore, and we meet with the beloved dead. And I'd done this ritual, visionary journey many, many times with that community. But this particular year, when I traveled in vision to the farther shore, Gwen was there and he said, okay, it's time for us to get married. And so the marriage ritual happened that way. And it was unexpected and kind of like almost a little anticlimactic, because I thought that I was going to, like, you know, in the voodoo tradition, they have a cake and they have a dress and they have the community there and they have a big party and there's marriage vows that are exchanged and rings and stuff. And it just didn't happen like that for me. But, you know, I also am not initiated into one of these more formal spirit marriage protocol traditions where that would be what was expected. And so after that, after 2018, what I notice is that it's not like Gwen impinges on my consciousness, but again, there is a daily way in which I have to show up and have communication and have communion. And I feel him more of as a somatic presence around me. But he also has been a huge road opener for me, getting the book deal, getting the book published, getting the information out there. This whole material, as Orion calls it, is the love child of my relationship with this being.
I understand very well what you're saying, because my wife and I are in a very similar relationship, only, of course, we got married in St. Patrick's Cathedral in the little lady chapel at the back of the cathedral when we were both in the physical. Mm-hmm. All right. You mentioned, interestingly enough, very briefly, voodoo. And we're going to end the free part of the show now. And subscribers, we're going to be talking now about a relationship or the story of a voodoo mambo called Suzette. And what that means, because we have had on the whole history of Dreamland only one show with a voodoo saint, a practitioner of voodoo. And it's got such a ludicrous reputation in the West. Mm-hmm. It's so unfortunate and so wrong, so childish. Mm-hmm. It is not childish. It is not demons. It is an extraordinary journey that is being taken by people in that religion into a relationship of a type that we don't have in the West anymore because we're too disenchanted. But we'll talk about this in just a minute. Free Dreamlanders, thank you as always so much. Excuse me while I have the hiccups, for being with us on Dreamland. And remember to go to drmeganrose.com and to explore spirit marriage, both her website and her book, and in your own life. This is possible. There's nothing wrong with it. There's no reason to be afraid of it. There is every reason to re-enchant the world around you by re-enchanting your own life and opening yourself up to the truly beautiful lady who made us all, our mother, the earth, and all who travel with her.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.